friends here. I can see behind those masks. Gosh, we have, you know, we've had so many premieres. In a way, this is our final one, which is kind of thrilling. We don't have a lot of people in New York right now, but Howard Gertler, the guy who produced the film and got this film made, got the rights to hear it. And Brian Cates, our editor, where the hell is he? He's back there! He's the second filmmaker, the second director. And Amber Martin, who not only sang, she sang four songs, a punk song, a funk song, a folk song, and a
fuck song.
What was the other one?
A sad song.
A sad song. Remember, you know, when mom's dancing in the pub at the end? So, you know, this came from a Neil Gaiman short story by the same name. Howard read it and said this should be a film, and 8 or 9 or 10 years later, here it is. You know, obviously, it's not a, like all of my films and Neil Gaiman's stories and Howard's films, they don't fit into one category, and, you know, which makes it a little harder to let people know about it. But like all my films, friends pass it on to other friends, so we're hoping you'll do the same. And I'd love to hear some questions. Or answers.
Who's first?
Yes.
Yes.
Eat Me Alive.
Yeah, how do you interpret about that part? Is it like, is that imagination or it really happened? Because when they make love, the virus makes love as real because she's
not pregnant. Yeah, it's, you know, it's the song when you get pregnant. It's that song. The nuns were right. Dance too close. Get pregnant. I don't know what that is, guys. You know, I'm from Broadway. I'm from musicals. Things like that happen in the middle of songs. Animation, outer space, you know. That was our true musical moment, wasn't it? You know, how did you know the words? I don't know, I love you. In some ways, you know, one of my favorite things that explains the whole style of the film is when, you know, the supreme alien, the sort of trans alien leader who's got a Queen Elizabeth hairdo, the great Edward Petherbridge, it's like, prepare for wide radius counter-ruption. I like to make up words for aliens, like interjaculate.
Yeah.
Counter-ruption. I'm like, why didn't he do that in the first place? Counter-ruption, which was a line that I cut. But I haven't finished yet. But what was I talking about? So it's like, and then they go, but N was not... you know, he's human, and yet he didn't get knocked out by the counter-ruption, and he goes, I'm an artist. So that explains that song. And other lapse in logic. Yes. Thank you. Yet 70s. Yeah, because, you know, the book... Those weren't actors, those were aliens, which are difficult to negotiate with. I don't have agents. You know, there was a lot of aliens in the short story, and I said, I've got to organize these aliens. I was a kid who grew up with making lists and categorizing my superheroes from my comics by their powers. So there were a lot of them. They needed to be herded, you know. So I was like, the chakras. They think of themselves as a whole, and the body celestial. And of course. course. Each colony is based on a chakra, the spirit, the mind, the voice. Zan is from the will, which of course is why she's willful and like a punk. The other people in her family are like, individuality, they say together, like North Koreans. But she's the true punk. And then there's the sexual, and then the perineum, which is about balance, and that's a wonderful acrobatic troupe named Barely Methodical. And so I thought, I told the designers too, you know, each chakra has a color system. You know, I want the aliens to look, they're taking human form, and they're taking the human form of what aliens look like in the 70s. Just different from what aliens look like now, because even aliens have fashion and nostalgia. So the designer, we had fun with that. You know, it's a tongue-in-cheek all the time, but a sincere heart. And ultimately, the new colony that's created by the punk and the controlled eco-closed system of the aliens is the heart, you know, which is the... It's interesting that the heart is about love, right? We feel the heart here when we're in love, but why is love here and not here or here? I think it's because the heart is not really an organ as much as a muscle, because it's a way station, it's a crossroads. You know, it's a way in and a way out. The interchange, and that's how the aliens survive. You know, if you interbreed, you know, you become deformed. If you drink your own urine, eventually you die. Which is what's happening with Brexit and possibly our country. So we have this, you know, accidental Brexit metaphor of people in British flags jumping off a building. True Freud contamination. And all the British people, when they see this film, are like, oh, yeah. Any more questions?
This is more of a career question.
I wouldn't ask me, I ain't got no money.
As a writer, director, performer, what turns you on the most?
It's my downfall, because I can only do things that I like. You know? I got a cheap rent from New York, and it allowed me to sort of wait to do things, you know, that I cared about. And, you know, Hedwig was really, because we wanted to make something new, Stephen and I, and it was, you know, all of our friends were like, it's not a very commercial project. Like, what do you do in drag after you did the Broadway? Because it's very low class. So the punk rock is not going to sell to the Broadway. I was like, I'm not trying to make something for somebody else. I'm trying to make something for So you know what you like. You know, that's one advantage of starting things late. You know, people say, they say, I can't start now. I mean, I started directing in my mid-30s and started writing after I was an actor. I mean, I did a little bit in college, but it really has to be about what's the right time. You know, I knew the films I loved. I knew what I liked by the time I made a film. Hedwig was my first film, and I hadn't made a short. But I knew what I liked. I just surrounded myself with people who were very experienced, and I looked at the things I liked, and I broke them down, and I said, oh, that's how they edited that scene. And the Sundance Lab was very useful for that. But it was just doing it, you know, and we were lucky enough not to have, you know, YouTube and too much information, because, you know, sometimes original things happen in the dark when you don't know everything. You know, David Lynch saw a couple of films that probably blew him away, and not everything is available on video and online, and so he made Eraserhead, which is unlike anything. You know, it's like originality comes from not knowing everything. You know, and it's good to keep it in the dark or not show it too soon. You know, don't show the fetus, show the baby. Right? I mean, just put that on a button. You know? And we have buttons. We have buttons for this in the lobby as you go out, so feel free. Yes?
I don't know,
because
how do you stay in love with the process?
Well, you surround yourself with people you love. You know, Howie and Brian is so easy to work with. It's just a joy you know, people who are positive. If you get a little down, you need people who are positive. You know, if you don't have ideas, surround yourself with people who do. You should never know everything going in, and never, you know, when directors freeze up in front of actors because they don't know how actors work or this or that, just go, you know, I don't know. You know, people love to help. You know, New Yorkers are, you know, not always smiling, but they love to give directions. You know, and they love a little vulnerability, right? A tour, they love a tourist because the tourist is like this. The New Yorker can step in, don't take the A. And then someone's next to them, take the F. What do you mean take the A? You know, they want to help. People do want to help if you give them a chance, and you have a problem and everyone is part of that solution. A director should never be a dictator. The fun of it is the making of it. This is fun too, but I really don't care how a film does. I never read reviews, look at box office. I never even ask how much I make because my films are so small. It's just whatever's fair. I just tell my producer, just do the, you know, write in the number that makes sense. When you have to make money, you know, it's a different thing. We all have to make money and pay bills, and now I have to go on tour, and, you know, I gotta make money. I hate negotiating. I used to be a tour de force, now I'm forced to tour. Someone over here. Yes, I mean that. What is punk? It's not punk to say. Right? It's like, what is obscenity? You know it when you see it. I mean, it usually has to do with questioning authority, questioning oppression, questioning conformity, questioning sheep-like attitude, questioning complacency. You know, the music scene was so boring to everyone in 74, or since 76. You know, the punks were so refreshing. We need some punk now. Oh, God. Because they could laugh and ridicule. I mean, I can't wait till I'm ridiculed, you know. Because then I know I'm really, you know, moved on. And there was something, they could make fun of, like, Eric Clapton, you know, and Mick Jagger could be made fun of. They didn't make fun of David Bowie. They saw him as a, you know, Iggy Pop David and Lou Reed were gonna pass. Because there'd be no punk without them. And I count as one of my friends is Danny Fields, who lives right nearby on 10th Street. And he came to me when I was doing Hedwig, and we became friends. And he discovered Iggy Pop. He signed the Ramones. He was a manager of the Ramones. And he said, you gotta see the singer, you know, for this band that we created, the Discords, Martin Tomlinson, who was in a band called Selfish Cunt, which was about capitalists. It's a band, very anti-capitalist band. He's amazing. And he, there'd be no punk without that fag, I tell you. But, you know, our punk was very queer, because at the beginning, punk was all the outsiders, you know. And Little Richard was the first punk, really. First punk was a sheep. And it got more right-wing and bro-ish, you know, as everything does. Until it, you know, as it dies. I have bro energy in me too. I like to get things done, you know. But it's like, you know, you putting it in the right direction, you know, instead of killing people that weren't like them or shooting them. But what was the question? Yes. Last question. Yes.
I just wanted to thank you for putting Bruno from the Homosexuals in the movie.
Do you know
that?
Yes. Bruno Wizard, who is the MC in the punk club, you know, he's like, Particle Punk Revolution! That's Bruno Wizard, who I can't remember where I first heard about them, but there's this band called The Homosexuals that was an unsung, the greatest punk, post-punk band. He was in a punk band called The Rejects, But he was too weird, you know, he was like, he was too nonconformist for the punks. They were like, you're supposed to have hair like that. And he's like, well, I want to have it a bit longer. You know? So right away, he was the punk of the punks. And check out the Homosexuals. It's hard to find their music. But he wasn't even gay. You know, and it was punk. And he chose the name of the Homosexuals as the members of the Slits did. So they would never be tempted in selling out because no radio station would play a band called the Homosexuals or the Slits. They'd play the Sex Pistols just barely, but they wouldn't say their name actually on the charts. That was the interesting, when they were number one, which was unconscionable, it said, you know, number two is like Rod Stewart, Maggie May. Number one, because they couldn't say, never mind the bollocks, which meant balls. They couldn't say Sex Pistols, so it was like blank. They were number one, blank generation. Any last fascinating question that I've never been asked? Between you two, I'll hear about them now, and I'll decide what's yours.
How did you spend the story and decide to land in England?
I didn't get that. Pero en español?
Sí.
Lentamente en español para mí.
La historia de Riemann son 15 minutos de lo que cuentas. Y luego las tiendes y vuelves a acabar en
Reino. Well, the short story is about 15 pages, about 15 minutes, and that's just the party and right before the party. So, I'm sorry about that. This was a good question. I've never been asked to use Spanish. And Philippa Goslett and Howard Gertler got the stories. They started the story. Philippa asked Neil what his childhood was like in Croydon. He was a teenager at that time, and he was a punk, and he had a punk band, and he had a zine. And so that became the story. So the kid became Neil, as you can see at the end, with the mullet. And we just thought, you know, he, and Neil actually said, the beginning is boy meets girl. That's act one. Act two is boy goes off with girl to his world. Act three is girl leaves. And, you know, the Romeo and Juliet stuff was natural, you know, punks versus aliens, you know, learning about each other. So we just went from that, you know, and that was simple. We didn't know why she left, but, you know, we had to go home. And everyone evolves or dies. You know, that was my thing. And that's, you know, like I said, we need a new punk. Maybe Emma Gonzalez, right? Yeah. She's the punk I want. Okay, if it's a quick question, I'll answer that one. Yes. Separated, and this one they come together, you know, and they create the new symbol of the anarchy with the lightning bolt. So they're both of their symbols are combined, human and alien, and like that. So I like myths. I grew up with myths, you know. The new thing I'm doing with Howard and Brian is a musical. But it's going to be an audio form called Anthem. It'll be a podcast series. You know, I'm not sure when it'll come out, you know, maybe 9 months or so. And it's Patti LuPone is my aunt, Glenn Close is my mother, Laurie Anderson is my tumor. I said I wrote it for you, Laurie. Couldn't think of anyone better. And again, you know, I'll probably lose money making it, but fuck, you guys will like it and share it with your friends. So tell your friends about this. Thank you.
Before we go, I want to thank all of you for being the kinds of New Yorkers that make your rent make sense. You come and do the great New York things you can't do elsewhere. And I want you to go out and tell your friends that not only will John be here tomorrow night with this film, but standing up here moderating and chatting will be Mr.
Stephen Trask from Hedwig, the composer from Hedwig, over here after the 7:45 show tomorrow. I'll introduce the 10 o'clock show tomorrow too and tonight. So, yeah, and that'll be the first time he's seen it, and, you know, furious that I didn't hire him as the composer. He was busy. So thank you so much, guys.